When telling a story, it's important to hook your audience. To make it impossible to leave before they see how it plays out. The opening scene of a movie is crucial for this reason. In our previous opening scenes video, we explored various methods filmmakers use to begin their stories. Today, we'll be examining six more ways to open your film. Sometimes you need to start before the beginning. With a prologue of the past that has direct influence on what happens in the present. This is called a flashback, a scene that takes place before the events of the rest of the film.
I don't have no father.
He passed before you were born, but you had a father.
What was his name?
The technique can serve many purposes, but first and foremost, it shows us a formative experience for our protagonist, something in their past that motivates their character. Or haunts them. Spider-Man, Into the Spider-Verse, uses a flashback to summarize the legend of its titular character.
All right, let's do this one last time. My name is Peter Parker. I was bitten by a radioactive spider. And for 10 years, I've been the one and only Spider-Man.
This gives us a solid foundation before this introduction of the multiverse turns it all upside down.
I thought I was the only one. You're like me.
I don't want to be.
I don't think you have a choice, kiddo.
A Quiet Place opens long after an alien invasion in a post-apocalyptic world. Now the sequel uses a flashback to show us how it all started. The day everything changed. This sequence accomplishes a few things at once. We get to see the Abbott family's idyllic life before the invasion.
Hey, what was that?
I don't know what that was.
I'm gonna take the kids home, okay?
Okay, yeah, my truck's up on Main Street, so.
Okay, all right, everybody in, let's go.
We get a front row seat during the initial attack. And we kickstart the movie with white knuckle action. But instead of starting in the past, you might want to start in the future. That means you're beginning with a flash forward. A flash forward is a scene that takes place at a future point in the film.
Did I hit something?
What the f*** is that?
This could be the middle.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
Or even the very end.
How long did you think you were inside?
Days. Maybe weeks.
It acts as the ultimate teaser and begs the question, how do we get here? With expectations now set, the audience has something to look forward to. Martin Scorsese has a knack for flash-forward opening scenes. Like this explosive moment from Casino. And we did an entire video on the opening scene of The Irishman. The Wolf of Wall Street opens with excess.
One!
Lots of excess.
Three! My name is Jordan Belfort. Not him, me.
We're thrown into the world of Jordan Belfort at its peak in this opener. The voiceover lists Belfort's absurd accomplishments.
The year I turned 26 as the head of my own brokerage firm, I made $49 million.
While showing us his various trophies.
See that humongous estate down there? That's my house. In addition to Naomi and my two perfect kids, I own a mansion, private jet, 6 cars, 3 horses, 2 vacation homes, and a 170-foot yacht.
So when we cut back to Jordan's modest beginnings, we can't wait to see the route he took to achieve his immodest success. But a flash forward isn't the only opening that can tease the audience. Our next type of opening is closely related to the flash forward. In medias res. In medias res is Latin for in the midst of things. And this type of beginning will often skip over a large portion of the story, including the inciting incident. In Mission Impossible, Ghost Protocol, this is the very first scene, but we know nothing about this situation. Who is this guy, and what's in the envelope? In medias res and flash forward openings are actually very similar. Like a flash forward, we jump ahead in time, but the difference is how we fill in the gaps. The flash forward will often go back to restart the story from the true beginning, but within medias res openings, there is often less recap. They can use production design. Dialogue.
It's been 2 months since Patient Zero took a bite of a contaminated burger at a Gas and Gulp.
Or even flashbacks to catch the audience up.
When you're afraid of everything that's out there, you quit going out there. Which is what happened to me before Zombieland. Friday night, third straight week indoors, World of Warcraft.
But usually, we simply start in the middle and keep going forward from there. Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope, also throws us into the middle of a pursuit without much context. The opening crawl gives us a bit of information, but we skipped over what would have been the entire first act. These questions will be answered eventually, but the immediate action is used to convince the audience to go along for the ride.
Did you hear that? They shut down the main reactor. We'll be destroyed for sure. This is madness.
Now, instead of dropping us into the middle of the story, our next type puts us in the middle of the mind.
Randolph! What is it, Mr. Furrow? Nothing.
A great way to build intrigue and subvert expectations is to start with a dream.
Just a dream.
Dreams lay out what is dominating your main character's psyche. Using abstract symbolism and imagery to put us directly in their subconscious. The cell opens with a child psychologist conducting a therapy session inside a patient's mind. Vanilla Sky opens with a dream sequence that is immediately captivating. We're introduced to a man obsessed with his looks and his success. This character has everything, which is echoed in the song choice. All seems relatively normal until David is entirely alone. Vanilla Sky establishes its main character's obsessions and fears, while also establishing a motif in the film, the mix of dreams with reality.
Even in my dreams, I'm an idiot who knows he's about to wake up to reality.
An opening scene can also set up expectations rather than subvert them. A bookend is an opening scene that is similar or identical to the final scene.
A rifle on my shoulder and a dagger in my hand, poor boy. If I had wings like Nora's dove.
By pairing the beginning and ending this way, the audience is able to see the entire story in a new context. Has this character grown, or are they stuck in their same old ways? It's also an effective way to mark just how much has changed during the film, or how everything is exactly the same. In Gone Girl, we begin and end with two nearly identical shots of Amy. The first is more neutral, but suggests an innocent or subservient wife. Then, Amy reveals her true self. And we can't help but see this last shot as a bit more sinister, with a tiny, devilish smirk.
What have we done to each other? What will we do?
The dynamics of their marriage have certainly changed, but they're back to square one, for now. 1917 has a particularly powerful bookend. The film opens with two lance corporals, William and Tom, catching some sleep in a picturesque field.
Blake.
Sorry, Sarge.
Pick a man. Bring your kit.
Yes, Sarge.
Then they're tasked with an impossible mission that puts them through hell.
Your orders are to get to the second at Quassy Wood, 1 mile southeast of the town of Bacust. Deliver this to Colonel Mackenzie. It is a direct order to call off tomorrow morning's attack.
We have to stop the bleeding.
In the final shot, William is alone, relieved to make it out alive, but his success has cost him dearly. The bookended scenes invite us to consider how William's life has changed between these moments. The situation is similar, but this character will never be the same again. What if instead of giving your audience a hint of what's to come, you want to deliberately mislead them? Enter the red herring. A plot device that creates expectations that are designed to mislead the audience. So, when the truth is revealed, it will have maximum impact. Think of Psycho, where we establish our lead character, Marion, along with her goals to pay her boyfriend's debts so they can get married.
A couple of years and my debts will be paid off. If she ever remarries, the alimony stops.
Oh, Sam, let's get married.
The audience becomes invested in Marion and her plight, and we expect to see her through to the end. Until... A great red herring opening scene can also be found in Shutter Island.
Yourself together, Teddy. Pull yourself together.
We meet our protagonist, U.S. Marshal Teddy Daniels.
Come on.
So you're my new partner, that's right.
We have no reason to assume this is anything more than a straightforward mystery.
Never seen a Marshal's badge before. I'm Deputy Warden McPherson, gentlemen. Welcome to Shutter Island. I'll be the one taking you up to Ashcliff.
But, as we learn in the third act, all of this is not as it seems.
Then they're not going to work on
you. You came here for the truth. Here it is.
Your name is Andrew Ladis. The 67th patient at Ashcliff
He's you, Andrew.
Teddy isn't Teddy at all. He's Andrew, a patient at the hospital, and the investigation turns out to be an elaborate form of therapy.
No, no.
My name is Edward Daniels!
Andrew, please don't.
Rewatching the opening scene, we can see subtle hints that something is off. The restraining chains Teddy walks by. The implausibility that he hadn't met his partner until this moment.
So you're my new partner, that's right.
This is the making of a good red herring. Attention to details.
Now,
remember that many of these types of opening scenes can be combined for even more dynamic storytelling. The Matrix Reloaded is both a flash forward and a dream. Twelve Monkeys starts with a dream, flashback, flash-forward hybrid.
Everybody be cool, this is a robbery!
Pulp Fiction is both in medias res, but also a flash forward.
Shoot every one of your motherfuckers! You got that!
Fuck this. In the bag. Fucking bag!
Yes. I don't have nothing on me, man.
What other examples of these opening scenes did we miss? What types should we cover next time? Let us know in the comments. You can flash back to our catalogue of videos. Or hit subscribe and enable notifications to flash forward to the topics we'll tackle in the future. We'll see you in the next one.